You're watching Pulsebeat with Greg Dunmore, and proving that dreams come true on this show, we're going to have a sneak preview of a show that is destined for international acclaim, Disney Plus Choir, which stars the awe-inspiring Detroit Youth Choir. So stay tuned.
And entertainment from Tinseltown to the Big Apple. This is your weekly entertainment magazine with Greg Dunmore of PulseBeat.tv.
Pulse of a new generation. PulseBeat.tv.
1, 2, ready. You can be anybody and be a part of the Detroit Youth Choir. We're the underdog out to prove what we can do.
Anthony, you now have joined and made history among these stellar names. When I think about the Vienna Boys Choir, the Boys Choir of Ireland, the Miss Jubilee Singers, even the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. Now the Detroit Youth Choir is iconic. Let us know your feelings from America's Got Talent to now being Disney superstars.
Well, it's like this. I feel that the AGT experience isn't the end of the world. You know, we have a legacy that we have to uphold. So the Disney experience doing this docu-series, it came to me, I want to say around the COVID pandemic. And from there, we prepared our kids that a camera would be there. A camera would be at all of our rehearsals. We knew that it was going to be producers there, directors there, but to be in the ranks of the Boys Choir of Harlem and the Tabernacle, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, I mean, that's truly amazing, man. And these kids deserve it, right?
It's a surreal moment. You know, we work hard a lot. You know, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears go into this. It's not easy. It's not for everybody. But we work hard for it, and I feel like we deserve every moment.
I'm super excited for, like, my peers and everybody. I feel like it's really going to be the peak for DYC. And I'm ready for it.
I've always had a lot of interest in doing, like, performing and being on TV and stuff like that. Like, I feel like every kid wants to be on TV at some point. So I feel real grateful and excited that this opportunity is coming so early in my life. Choir coming out and all of the Detroit youth being shown in such a big and grand scale is really, like, important, and it gives us a lot of opportunities moving forward, because I feel like Disney Plus is a huge, gigantic platform, right? So it's like us being everywhere and, like, being shown on TV and stuff like that is real big, and I feel like choir opens up a door for way more, like, entertainment youth groups and choirs for the future. So I feel like I'm really glad that choir is kickstarting that type of trend.
Detroit is coming back, and I believe 2024 is our year.
The Detroit Youth Choir has captured the hearts of Detroiters since 2019 with that remarkable America's Got Talent run. And now to be featured on a 6-part Disney Plus documentary is just amazing. There is enormous talent among the youth in our city, and what Mr. White has done with the Detroit Youth Choir is bring that talent to the forefront, and Detroiters are just really proud. I think you're going to see from the documentary that nothing compares to hard work and dedication, and the young people at DYC, they are all about that hard work, and it has paid off with national and now global attention.
The whole production company has been amazing towards the Detroit Youth Choir. They sent us to New York a few times, and you know we're a nonprofit, right? So they already did their donation to us. They gave us this, they gave us that. So now we're just here to reap the benefits. And what this docuseries is going to do is open the window of opportunity for our organization. You know, sometimes money and all that stuff, that's not important, you know. It's all about getting these young people into the eyes of America and the world. So I say, you know, thank you Blumhouse, thank you Disney, thank you Imagine, thank you Maniac Productions. Because without them, I mean, we wouldn't even have a show on Disney Plus.
I'm just ready to get on that stage and prove all those people that were saying that we don't belong here wrong.
At the core, you just have this wonderful organization, these wonderful kids who are doing such amazing things. And I think teaming that up with me and my team, who wanted to come here and allow this team to be emblematic of Detroit, and not necessarily vice versa. You know, so often when you hear about Detroit, even though we know it's not true, you hear all of these negative connotations about what this means, what the city is. And we wanted to come here and show a different version of what it means to grow up in this city. A story of hope, a story of resilience, a story of agency, and a story of just great kids not having to have this asterisk put next to them by saying, oh, Detroit is this or Detroit is that. Let them tell you what Detroit is.
There was a time in my life where I never thought I could even get this far, but it did. So, hey, Mom, we made it.
Because we practice almost all the time, and it's exhausting, but it helps us.
Yeah, I would say the practice, too. Like, it is a very fundamental part of who DYC is. And I just think it's truly amazing that we can have the time to practice and then put it on the stage to show you guys.
Where have you seen a youth choir on a major stage like this besides the late great Boys Choir Parlor? This is pretty much, we're pretty much given a new face to choir. You know, when we went to America's Got Talent, they thought that we were gonna sit there and go, la, 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 you know what I'm saying? But we came out with a hip hop song. And they didn't expect that from a choir. And I just want people to know that the way people look at choirs has to change.
I want you to pass on something that is empowering, that can only come from a man that has proven that dreams do come true.
Well, I just want to let the young people out there know that go to college, get your degree, because without a degree, it's like you're just out here, you know. However, a lot of people are successful without going to college, but when you have that paper, you will have a job all the time.
And there would be no youth choir without Detroit, and there would be no Detroit youth choir without the awe-inspiring Mr. Anthony White.
Thank you, sir.
This is the hardest I've ever tried for anything.
Just breathe.
This your spot, this your moment.
I want to be someone that people remember.
It takes many performers a lifetime to make it to Carnegie Hall. So consider yourselves among the elites.
This is one of the grandest moments that I'll ever have in my life.
We want to be that choir that changes lives again and again.
Showtime.
Make sure you watch Choir and streams on Disney Plus. I can't wait to see you there.
PulseBeat.
What happened to your business idea you've been dreaming about? Build Institute offers business and project planning classes for aspiring and established entrepreneurs. We'll help you launch and test your concept, provide access to capital funding, and provide one-on-one coaching and mentoring. So don't just dream about starting your business, build it with Build Institute. Classes begin February 1st. To register and for more information, visit us at www.buildinstitute.org.
PulseBeat.
Welcome back to PulseBeat with Greg Dunmore, and we're about to talk about something that I absolutely love, but not more than you, but movies, and we're really honored to have one of the real movie connoisseurs, and that would be Mr. Elijah Boykin Jr., who is the author of Towards a New Cinema. I want you to brag a little bit concerning why you are so knowledgeable concerning movies, Elijah.
Anybody can do it. You just gotta watch thousands of movies, which I've done. So, you know, I'm ready to talk about it. I write reviews and hopefully putting out a third volume of Toward a New Cinema soon. So let's hit it, you know.
But now we're gonna talk about what we like and what we don't like. Mm-hmm. So let's look at Killers of the Flower Moon.
They told me you was going with Matt Williams for a time.
You talk too much.
No, I don't talk too much. Just thinking who I gotta beat in this horse race, that's all.
I didn't realize this was a race. I don't care for watching horses.
Well, I'm a different kind of horse.
Hong Fashi. Shomikasi Sheko Shiajimi.
What was that?
Shomikasi. That's how you are.
I don't know what you said, but it must have been Indian for handsome devil.
I am an Osage brave. A long time ago, we Osage took our name from Missouri and Osage rivers. Niukanska, children of the middle waters. Move, said the great white father, from Missouri, from Arkansas, from Kansas, finally, another strange land, Oklahoma, where famine walk by day and hungry wolves by night. Can you find the wolves in this picture?
All right, let's go. Come on.
Osage weren't ever part of the five civilized tribes.
Remember Blackie Thompson?
Howdy, boys.
Of the five civilized tribes, the Cherokee, Chickasaw, Choctaw, Creek, and Seminole.
Don't move!
Ooh, that rock still shines in the dark, boys. Give me here.
Just take the car. Don't take my ring. My father gave it to me.
Don't want the car, just want the jewels. Y'all didn't do nothing to earn this anyway.
You like these?
Got us some rich Indians, boys.
Come on.
You know, the Golden Globes got it absolutely wrong when they did not name Leonardo DiCaprio as their actor, best actor honor. I mean, I was insulted because I thought that he gave a tour de force performance of a lifetime. And what say you, Elijah?
Nah, I doubt it. As far as I'm concerned, you know, the person that anchored that film was Lily Gladstone.
I got too much.
And she was a find, okay? She had a quality like Olivia de Havilland or Ingrid Bergman, and I'm really looking forward to seeing her do more high-profile films in the future with more acclaimed directors. DiCaprio, he'll get his Oscar eventually, you know, but to have the first Native American female actually win a Golden Globe, to me something that was, I could celebrate that, and quite frankly, after I saw that film, I was a fan of hers.
Well, they got that part right. She was excellent, and she was a true find, and I'm wishing her the absolute best, but for best actor, I am still very adamant about Leonardo DiCaprio was among the best I've ever seen. So you're not necessarily as convinced that I am that he's gonna win the Oscar. Oscars get it right.
Well, see, the whole thing is, that's sort of a given, see. But the fact that Lily Gladstone, you know, came out a Native American and won a Golden Globe, that wasn't a given, you know. But it's a good thing for the culture, especially American culture, that you have the Native Americans actually making a viable and visible presence in the cinema media. And that's why, you know, I enjoy
it. It was history making, yeah, I agree. But I am still one that I understand the importance of representation, and certainly the Native Americans have been minimized, but it is an award based on acting, not about ethnic background. And so therefore, I know that we want representation, but I'm really one that I'm very objective about. I'm not voting on them because of the ethnic background. It's based on the expertise that they bring to the table as an actor.
Well, see, there's probably half a dozen roles that Leonardo DiCaprio rightly could, you know, have won Best Actor for. The same with Kirk Douglas and a few others. See, a lot of actors don't think that awards are, you know, really a good way to judge merit or talent anyway.
Yeah.
George C. Scott, actually, he refused his Oscar since he thought it had degenerated into a beauty contest more than anything else. And Humphrey Bogart said, well, you know, it's not the same as pole vaulting or, you know, running a race, you know, who's first, second, or third. How do you judge one person's, you know, performance against another? It's a totally different story. It's totally different character and whatnot. He thought, you know, it was kind of iffy about that, you know.
I know.
But it's okay to, you know, recognize and appreciate people's performances. Sure, you want to do that.
That's true. But you know, it's the fun of it. And you are right that an award doesn't make you the alpha or omega.
Exactly.
I totally agree on that. But there's still something about the coveted Academy Award, whether you like it or not, that sells a picture on a certain level. Not like it used to be, but it's still an honor that we don't want to devalue. And Leonardo DiCaprio, I'm saying it again,
he should win the Oscar. See, that's
the
point. I want to devalue it, okay? Because the whole point is, mostly what the Oscars do, mass media do, is celebrate the white patriarchy, okay? And it celebrates the culture that was actually developed from the postulates of the great white fathers and the founding fathers, known as Lincoln, Franklin, Jefferson, and whatnot, okay? Because I think it was Selma. I was, you know, parking cars out there at Hertz, and the guy asked me, why didn't Selma win more awards, or why didn't it win any award? And I said, it was shoot, you're always trying to get the approval and acceptance of the so-called, you know, they call it the dominant culture. I don't see it that way. But you did, what about the Michelle Awards? Or, you know, the BET Awards. You know,
right.
Those are things you should focus on. Just understand that, you know, pretty much, and that's why that was such a breakthrough that Lily Gladstone won the Golden Globe.
Yes, which is
for Best Actress, because by and large, all your awards is celebrating, you know, and these are considerable accomplishments. I'm not devaluing that, but mostly it's just celebrating the achievements of the white patriarchy.
It is, except Leonardo DiCaprio, be he black or white, gave a definitive performance, in my opinion, unhumble opinion.
Yeah.
And I understand what you're saying, and I don't take away from, we shouldn't put more emphasis on the award than we
sometimes
do on the essence of the talent.
Thing.
And the essence of what Leonardo DiCaprio did was superlative.
But I'm not in any kind of trouble at all. None at all.
Killers of the Flower Moon is the best movie of the year.
My wife likes her nice things, so
not as much as you do.
You're picking a fight with the wrong person.
You're gonna make trouble, make it big.
You gotta tell me what you told them. All of it, what you tell them.
I told them all of it.
All of it?
You're nice.
God.
Have you told all the truths?
The next film that also we had a chance to see, A Color Purple, mm-hmm. The musical.
Sure. That was a fascinating film.
Today, our teacher taught us about a place called Africa. She say our mamas come from Queens over there. That means that we royalty.
I don't need you to love me.
Afternoon. I need me a wife.
They're saying that A Color Purple, the musical, is a F-L-O-P flop. What say you, Elijah Boykin?
I enjoyed the musical. You know, I thought it made good points. It was just interesting because, you know, comparing it to the original, The Color Purple. You know, it was Quincy Jones that asked Steven Spielberg if he would direct that. And Steven Spielberg, he was hesitant about it. He said, well, why don't you get, you know, an African-American director who's more closer to the subject, you know, and has a cultural background to do it and whatnot. And I think Quincy Jones said, well, no, you're the best there is, you know. You didn't know anything about Mars, but you did E.T., you know, but that's the whole point. Right. You wanted the best there was to actually treat Alice Walker's story, The Color Purple, you know. But the point is that it was good, you know, but the pulse of the times is a little bit different post-COVID.
Right. Okay?
People are looking for something a little bit different to release their angst, their charge about, you know, the way times are, especially after, you know, what has happened with Trump and whatnot. So that's the whole thing. You'd be surprised, like with Barbie. People wanted something, you know, to...
Something light so they could get to... I didn't like Barbie. I saw the movie. I thought it was terrible. Yeah. But I know that people loved it. But you know what? Now, I love Oprah Winfrey on the level that the world embraces her as being, once again, history-making for what she did as a talk show icon. But as a person who connects herself to movies, I think it's the Oprah curse. I think that's what it is because Oprah, she... is one that when she has the minus touch on the talk show circuit, but for films, when she puts her finger on it, something tends to take a wrong turn. Now, the acting, Fantasia, I'm a big Fantasia fan, and this was her first movie, and I wanted more out of Fantasia, and I'm looking for her to do more, but she didn't do what Barbara Streisand did in Funny Girl, which would have been her first movie, and she was someone that became iconic, but I wanted Fantasia to repeat that sort of Barbara Streisand success. That didn't happen. Now, we know that Oprah Winfrey was nominated for the Academy Award in the original movie, playing Sophia and Danielle Brooks. She was outstanding, and I think that she is going to win Best Supporting Actress for the Academy Awards, as she did for the Golden Globes. Did you like what she did playing Sophia?
I did. There's a little set piece in there that I'm not going to mention because that'd be a spoiler alert.
Right.
You know, but there's one set piece where they were singing to each other. I thought that was really well presented and well done. But see, you're waiting for Oprah Winfrey to do Madam C.J. Walker and be done with it, okay? Because she's so much like that personality, and she, oh, we'll do it one day and whatnot, but she hasn't done that yet. But to me,
hopefully she won't play it.
You know.
Hopefully she, but see, there's the Oprah curse, that whenever she puts her finger on a movie, it's not going to be the billion-dollar bang that the billion-dollar Oprah, it doesn't actually correlate for this upcoming Academy Awards on March 10th on ABC. But I would say that I think enough is enough. No more Color Purple. I think we've seen enough of that.
We are more than just kings and queens. We are at the center of the universe. Oh, yes, I am.
Pulsebeat.